Training and DEI Program Manager, and Sarah Wilkinson, our Program Manager. I also have a staff of talented consultants that help us with training and our TA work. And again, you may see some of them on the lines just to become familiar with them. And at this time, I wanted to just start off, as you know, our topic is helping young people manage anxiety and depression. So I wanted to take a moment of reflection just so that we know why we are discussing this topic. Take a moment to remember what it was like for you to be in middle or high school. What were you worried about and what brought you joy? Now imagine that there was a global pandemic happening while you were in school. How would that disruption have affected you? How would it have made you feel? And before I open it up to our panelists, would there be someone on the line that would want to kind of talk about this reflection?
So I will just give my quick reflection. So when I was in high school, I was mainly worried about how to just get through the day, like how to get through many of the assignments that I had to make, the deadlines I had to make. And then I think what brought me joy was just the simple act of belonging, because I was an orchestra kid. So I was part of that group. And I think that's what brought me joy and what I was worried about at the same time.
And is this Lynn that was speaking?
This is Alexandra.
Alexandra. Thank you for sharing that, Alexandra. Mm-hmm. So I suspect, like many of us, that was kind of the balance of things. We're worried about getting our assignments done, things like that. But what brought us joy was really connecting with our social network and our friends that we knew that we were going to see each day, whether it would be at lunch or kind of talking after school activities. And then, you know, now that reflection of if there were a global pandemic, I think for, you know, me, it would be like, okay, how do I get my assignments done now? What does that feel like being online for the full day? I don't get to see my friends. So, you know, really just kind of setting the stage for what we're going to discuss today. So with that, I wanted to open up and introduce three of our panelists. The first one is Janine, and you'll see her bio here on the screen, and I'll give her a few moments to introduce herself as well. Janine.
Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for having me here today. I'm excited about having this important discussion. So my name is Janine. I am the founder of Living Wellness, which is a private group practice here in Chester, Virginia. I've been in the field of mental health for over 15 years, working in a variety of different settings and situations. Right now, I focus mainly on working with teens, mostly girls and adult women, struggling with depression, anxiety, self-esteem challenges, and work-life balance. And so I'm excited to be here today to impart some knowledge and experience from my group practice.
Thank you. Our next panelist is James. If you would like to introduce yourself, please.
Hey, what's going on, good people? My name is James Harris. I'm a father, veteran, entrepreneur, also a therapist located right here in Richmond, Virginia. I work with men, boys, families, group settings, individual settings. I'm also an author of a book called Man, Just Express Yourself, which is an interactive planner guide for boys and men to better express themselves. That's on Amazon, Barnes & Noble, Target, Walmart, and of course my website. And I'm also the founder of a movement called Men to Heal, which focuses on men's overall wellness, their mental health, physical health, and of course their emotional health. I got a spot in Richmond called the Healing Hub, which offers yoga, mindfulness, Zumba, Reiki, just so many different things, feeding the less fortunate every third Saturday. So connect with me if you want to.
Thank you so much, James. And finally, Dr. Robinson.
Yes. Hi, good morning, everyone. My name is Dr. Robinson. I have a private practice that specializes in substance abuse and addiction, but also deals with sexual offending and rape and trauma. I've been in the field for about over 20 years. I started my career working with the intellectually disabled population, and then I ventured out. I've done intensive in-home and everything under the sun, but then I found that my true passion and calling has been working with substance abuse. So I offer services to teens, tweens, adults, and geriatric, and I'm glad to be here this morning.
Thank you so much. So with that being said, I'm going to ask the panelists some questions. We'll kind of do a round robin, and then we will have time to do some Q&A with them individually as well. So let's start with Janine. How does anxiety and depression affect the behavior of young people, and how can it show up differently for different youth?
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, I think it's important to put things into context. The National Institute of Health reports that one in every three youth aging from 13 to 18 years old could experience a anxiety diagnosis. And so we're certainly seeing a higher rate or increase of anxiety with the pandemic. And so we want to be mindful of what some of those symptoms may look like. You want to try to see if there are any changes in behavior. Are your youth avoiding certain activities? Are they showing signs of irritability? And are they being argumentative, you know, with others? Isolation and withdrawal. Are they reporting that there are a decrease in their grades and changes in appetite and lack of sleep? These are some of the things that you want to kind of pay attention to, and could be indicators that there could be something else that's going on that needs further exploration.
Great, thank you. And for James, how can adult mentors and volunteers support young people who are struggling with mental health?
So they can do that in a couple of different ways, but can I go back to mention what you had from the last question? Because I think now that we're in the pandemic, it's also important that parents or mentors or, you know, coaches or teachers recognize too that there are physical signs of anxiety and depression, and it might overlap while they're in your classroom. So it's important to recognize those racing heartbeats, the crying, the headache, the dry mouth, the nausea, because those things are important. You know, we don't want those to get, you know, passed off as a somatic symptom or, you know, or illness, opposed to actually the child is actually dealing with something such as fatigue or anything like that. And those translate into those behaviors, whether that's anger and aggression, you know, because they tend to not be able to know how to articulate what they want to say. But once you get past those things, or once you're able to identify them, some of the things that adults and mentors can do is, you know, be a listening ear, be a support system. But I think a lot of times we forget to give children grace because we think, like, you know, it's a behavior issue opposed to something else that's a little bit deeper. So I think we can continue to uncover those layers, build that rapport, you know, create a cohesive bond so they can feel comfortable with coming to us if they do have an issue, or if it is something that they want to express. You know, oftentimes they want to go to somebody or be in a position to discuss certain things, but they don't know who to do that. They can't identify their allies because it's always a reprimand opposed to a teaching moment. So I think many adults probably have to do a better job at creating those teaching moments. You also can look online and find different checklists for anxiety or depression and go from there if you need to.
Great, thank you. I like how that you put the positive on that. We're looking for those behaviors, but instead of reprimanding what's going on right now, really kind of peeling back the layers and how to be an ally in those teaching moments. I think that is very important right now. And for Dr. Robinson, what resources can mentors and programs connect young people, their families, when they are struggling with mental health?
Well, actually, you know what? There are various resources. You can go to your local, you know, community services board, or even you can possibly start at the school to see what the school is offering. Your school counselor is there, but a lot of times parents or caregivers aren't really sure of how to go about it. And then they can find various programs such as the one that we are on now. And then just, you know, work with the child and just let the child know that, hey, you know what? It's okay. Work with that teenager to say, hey, you know what? It's okay not to be okay. Because too many times we pass up the notion of identifying as being okay. Well, what does okay mean? You know, last time I checked, when I said that something is okay, I'm like, I'm not 100% to it and not 100% against it. I'm just okay. But then you have to dig deeper, and how James and Janine said, you want to create that safe space so that the teen will be open, or the child, or even the caregiver will be open to those resources. But I would definitely start with your local community services board, because you will definitely be able to start there and then weed out what works and what might not work. And then you also want to know what style that child may be open to. You know, we still are in a pandemic. So, you know, maybe they're not ready to be in a closed, you know, setting or something. Maybe they're okay with, you know, maybe virtual or possibly doing other things, you know, such as maybe yoga. You know, sometimes we really have to think outside the box and give, you know, children and caregivers options, because everyone is not a sit down, talk to someone, whatever type of person.
I really like some of those points that you said, you know, letting them know, first of all, it's okay not to be okay. To give them kind of permission to be in this space, and the importance of creating that safe space so that they will come to you. And I like the idea of alternative ways to kind of talk to them. I think some of us have even heard, you know, do a walking kind of meeting or the virtual space or things like that. So those are all good tips. Back to Janine, what is the best way for mentors to check in with young people about their mental health? Mm-hmm.
And just to kind of piggyback off of what everyone else is saying, is certainly making sure that the foundation there is a relationship that is built upon trust. But certainly showing up as a mentor and coming with a listening ear, right? Being patient, showing genuine interest in what's going on with the team, maybe asking some how and what questions, you know, how are you feeling today? How can I support you? What is it that you need me to know about how you feel? You know, what's going on in this particular situation? Let's have an open dialogue about it. Lean in with curiosity and, you know, ask for if they want for you to offer some advice. Because in my experience, most teens don't want advice, you know? They want you to be able to listen to what they're saying. And so, you know, you can share your own stories or stories that you've heard of and different things like that, if they're interested in that. But, you know, I think the foundation of all of this is making sure that it is a safe space and that you are showing genuine interest in what's going on with them.
Thank you so much. I really like how you said that, you know, ask those how and what questions. And do you want advice? I know this is something that when I do training too, we talk about, do you want a solution or do you want empathy in the moment? Sometimes it helps just to ask the person, you know, because if we go in right with the solution on the front end, then they shut down because in that moment they needed empathy. Absolutely. Okay, for James. What are some tools that mentors can use to help youth learn to regulate their emotions, manage anxious thoughts, and practice self-care?
So I think it's a couple of different ones. And I also have a YouTube channel with a couple of different videos on there that people can benefit from. And one of those videos is socio-emotional learning, tough parenting conversations, and there's a couple other ones on social skills and coping skills and things like that. But I think just off top, due to a time restriction, you can identify your coping skills, identify a strong support system as well. And as an adult, I think it's important that you don't pass judgment because we are in a new time. And what I mean by that is it's the influence of the outside world is way greater than our influence, even as a parent, because they're outside the home more than they used to, whether that's at school, after school activities. And of course, now we have social media. So we have to ensure that we're allowing them to do those things within moderation that don't consume as much of that time, because all information is not good information. So we want to ensure that we're providing that good information. And by not passing judgment, as in, I had to catch myself the other day with my teenager. She wanted to wear Crocs out the house. You know, how I grew up is, you know, you're not wearing flip-flop slides out the house. But of course, we get to the mall and every teenager in there got Crocs on. So it's a new time. We have to make that adjustment. You know, because to them, it could have been, well, to her, it was more of an anxiety. But like, why wouldn't you just let me be me? So, you know, so it's a different time. I think we all have to continue to adjust and evolve and dealing with the pandemic. So that mindfulness is important. And I know a lot of people don't know how to breathe. They think they know how to breathe, but to just sit and be grounded or stand and be grounded and just become one with your breaths, you know, it's a whole different thing, breathing from your diaphragm and understanding, you know, centering yourself, building that mindfulness toolbox, and all of those things are definitely important. And also you can do exercise too, being that we are in the house or in the office, you know, those things are definitely important. Journaling, you know, I find that to be helpful as well.
Great. Thank you so much. I really like how you first started off with not passing judgment on these young people in the moment, and really talking about the significance of the outside influences. If we go back to that reflection question, when I was young in middle school and high school, you know, yes, there were some outside influences, but there wasn't the, you know, social networks in that capacity. So the worst that you heard from someone was someone passed a note about you, right? But now it's all over the internet if someone has said something about you that can be jarring. So young people kind of sitting through those things. I love your tips on self-care. Even at Mentor Virginia, before our staff meetings, we try and ground ourselves. And I think if all of us create more of a practice for whether you be in school, at work, with your friends, just to take a moment to ground, that's super important. For Dr. Robinson, how can mentors help young people develop self-advocacy skills that help them speak up about their mental health needs?
Great question. So if anything, the mentors can just help foster confidence within the teen and encouraging them to be them, to just be your true authentic self, and just to, you know, help them understand to say that, hey, you know what, just because someone does not understand you or agree with you, that does not make you less than. So, you know, you can have them do and give them, you know, daily affirmations. I know that's what I give myself. I'm an adult and I have to do, you know, daily affirmations to start my day. And then even in my office, I have the different affirmations posted on my wall. So I can only imagine, you know, as a teen, you know, trying to find who you are. Well, you're still learning. So you just want to foster and just let them know that, hey, it is okay for you to be you, and here's how you can do it. You know, and you just speak positivity with them, and then just engage them in conversations and say, hey, you know what? Where do you see yourself? How do you feel about yourself? Because they want to talk. They just want someone to listen. Now, we've been saying the whole entire time, listen without judgment. No, even though we might not understand what they're going through these days, you know, because Natalie, how you mentioned, you know, and the rest of us, when we were in high school, we didn't have this. You know, and now whatever with the pandemic, I mean, I'm still struggling. And I know, you know, that all I just had to do was just, you know, transition certain things. I didn't have to, you know, literally shut off from seeing friends and just, you know, being maybe in an unsafe environment. So now you just want to just, you know, just talk with them and engage them in activities that's going to build their confidence. And if they don't know what they want to do, give suggestions. And as I said before, just leave that safe space because they want it.
Right. Thank you for all of those, you know, really talking about those daily affirmations and those important things. And I really think as adults, for us to model those things. You know, I know that last night I had a friend come over and she brought my daughter and I some soup and we just enjoyed conversation. And so just really kind of coming back to those things that bring us comfort and joy and having those open conversations. So some of the conversations my daughter might not have had with me, but there was another adult there, a friend that, you know, she could kind of piggyback and have some of those conversations. I also have, and I'm gonna kind of put her on the spot, see if she'll come on, Tashara, who's on our staff, who really does a lot of affirmation work as well. She is great each day when we kind of talk about things. Tashara, can you come on the line and kind of talk about your experience as well?
Yes, good morning, everyone. You'll have to excuse my camera not being off because I'm trying to get some things together. But my daughter and I both are living with depression and anxiety. And so as a way of trying to help her center herself, especially during this pandemic, one of the things that I've started doing with her is daily affirmations. And so we have a new one right now where I have her say, I am thankful for a new day. I am thankful for a new week. I am thankful for a new semester. I am thankful for a new season. I will shine. I will soar in my beauty, in my brains, and so much more. And then we listened to one of the Fearless Souls inspirational speeches on our way as I'm taking her to school every morning, because I've noticed that she takes on a lot of my emotions and she's carrying a lot, but she does not express it herself. And she feels like she has to take care of me because she knows the things that I'm dealing with. And so one day in a random outburst, I noticed that something was off and I asked her what was going on. And she said, living is hard right now. We are in a pandemic. There's still the Black Lives Matter going on. I don't know what's happening in school. This is actually, as I was explaining to my team, this is her first year in a public school, her first year in face-to-face, because when she started the school last year, it was all virtual. And so she's in a new place in a new school for the first time face-to-face. She's in the eighth grade. And so she's really just struggling trying to figure out what to do, how to navigate life, how to make friends, who are the good friends, who are not the good friends. And so she says she's just overwhelmed because there's just so much going on. And as a parent, it broke my heart to hear that she was carrying so much. But at the same time, I was grateful that she got to the point where she was able to share. So we just do daily affirmations every day, listen to Fearless Soul. And then I also have her in art classes until we can find her a therapist or a counselor so that she can kind of paint out and draw out a lot of those emotions.
Thank you so much, Tashara, for sharing your story. Like I said, most of us either are working with young people or have young people of our own and watching them kind of navigate all of these things. Janine, do you think young people are feeling a sense of dread and hopelessness?
That many young people are feeling that, especially with the pandemic. There's a lot of fear, there's a lot of unknown, a lot of uncertainty about what the future holds, about what it brings. And so, like everyone else is saying, I think it's important that we instill a little bit of hope. You know, we talk about our options. How do we manage, you know, living in such a uncertain time right now? You know, what can we do on a small scale every single day to make sure that we're okay and checking in with each other and reminding each other that it's okay to not be okay, like everyone is saying, you know, and to just take it one moment at a time, one day at a time, and to think about something good to look forward to, you know, to focus maybe our attention and energy on some of those things can be helpful to manage those feelings of dread and uncertainty.
And as a follow-up to that, what can mentors and mentoring programs do to combat these feelings?
So one of the things that I wanted to also kind of talk about in addition to that is, you know, practicing mindfulness, practicing some of those grounding techniques, really encouraging our youth to take some time to pause. So there's an acronym that I use with many of my clients called STOP. And this stands for, the essence thought means to stop, right? To take a pause. The T stands for take a breath. As we kind of talked about, you know, utilizing some deep breathing techniques, it's important to just kind of calm our central nervous system. So we're going to pause, take a deep breath. The O stands for observe. And, you know, with mindfulness, this is an opportunity to put some separation between ourselves and our feelings, to be an observer, to bear witness to what's going on around us, to bear witness to our thoughts and our emotions, our bodily sensations, to also engage our senses, you know, to pay close attention to what we see, what we hear, what we smell, what we taste, and what we can feel. And then the last thing is the P stands for proceed. So at that point, we can make an informed decision about how we're going to navigate ourselves, our feelings and emotions, and acting out of being more responsive than being reactive, you know, to situations. And I think if we just take that time to pause and to really collect ourselves, and we can, you know, better manage some of the struggles and challenges that we're seeing.
Great, thank you. And I have a question for Dr. Robinson. I know sometimes when I train mentors, we talk about the concept of secondary trauma, you know, that as people in the helping field or mentors, to gauge whether we are taking on some of the, you know, heaviness that young people are having, and what signs can we do to kind of take care of ourselves and make sure that we don't get into that compassion fatigue?
If anything, we want to focus on self-care. Okay, I cannot stress that enough. And for some reason, people feel that, you know, self-care has to be something extravagant, you know, something that's going to cost a whole lot of money. Like, oh, in order for me to do self-care, oh, I have to, you know, go off to Europe, or I have to go and, you know, buy a chateau. No, it's just whatever you find comfort in. Like, it could be, you know, just a nice piece of food. I don't know about you guys, but I love red velvet cake. Okay. I could have a stressful day and my husband will get me a slice of red velvet cake or red velvet cheesecake, and I just take a bite into it, and all that I'm feeling from working with my clients and that, you know, vicarious trauma and that secondary trauma, and it just all goes away. Or even, let's just say, knitting, crocheting, whatever you find comfort in that comes easy and is relaxing, take it. But we also have to remember that, guess what? You don't have to put a time length on this. I was just talking with a colleague and she was asking me what I was doing. And I said, I'm doing self-care. She said, but you're talking to me. I said, yes, while I am talking to you, guess what? I am laying down. Yes, I have my weighted blanket on me. Yes, I have my comfortable pillow. That's my self-care. She was like, well, don't you have a busy day? I said, really, to tell you the truth, all I need is 5 to 10 minutes to get what I need to refocus. So it doesn't have to be an hour, doesn't have to be hours. Now, if you can spare that, sure. As a mentor, yes, we're going to need that. But we have to get in the self-care and be intentional about it. Because when you work with others, how can you give when you are depleted? Because you are going to take on what these kids are going through. And it's heavy. So how is heavy supposed to operate with heavy? I don't know. So whatever you find comfort in, whether it's shopping, whether it's food, whether it's a good book or a television show, I'm going to be honest, every day before I go to bed, I have to watch one episode of The Big Bang Theory. That just ends my day, because I can't have, you know, red velvet cake every day, all day. No, but just doing that. And then therefore that helps refresh and gives me more motivation to continue doing what I am doing, because we do not want to suffer from burnout, because these kids need us. And if we're burnt out, where are they going to go?
Yes, I think that's a very important message, as we're hearing in the school systems that teachers are burning out, you know, all of staff. And I like that your tips are about self-care. They can be very small things that we can do. You know, my daughter has a weighted blanket as well, where sometimes I put my favorite blanket in the dryer and then just wrap it around me just for that warmth and comfort. You know, and creating a routine of self-care, whether it be in the morning, that hot cup of coffee, or at night with your show. I think those are all great tips. James, I'd like to go back to you, since you are, you know, working with young men. I think in society, we think that women share their feelings more openly, you know, but can you tell us a little bit more about what you're seeing with young men, how they're expressing themselves, or some good techniques for them?
Yeah, so in most cases, I think many people don't know how to express themselves or don't know how to articulate what they want to say. So in the cases of young men and boys, they tend to act out. So whether that's being aggressive or irritable, you know, being irritable in those cases, that's how it manifests itself. So things I do to prevent that is help them articulate what they want to say, whether that's through journaling or drawing or teaching mindfulness practice and things like that. But to go back a little bit further, I think it's definitely important that we also highlight the importance of boundaries, because a lot of people have boundaries, but not many people enforce that boundaries, which create other issues. So by teaching boundaries, you teach what you have to accept or what you don't have to accept, depending on where you are within that spectrum or that relationship. And I think those things are important as well, because then it starts to bleed over to, okay, I recognize this person is modeling a certain behavior. Let me interject myself. Let me support them, or let me show them different ways that they can express themselves so they can't, you know, get in trouble, or they can stop being irritable, or they can articulate a little bit better, opposed to acting out or getting, you know, put out the classroom or being aggressive to this other peer. So those things are definitely important. And in many cases, young people want to learn. They just need those examples of how to do it. And being that you asked about young boys, it hasn't been historically a lot of positive male influences that teaches the positivity of how to do certain things. Or from the just adult standpoint, I guess in the generations that we're probably in, it's been allowing boys to mask their feelings. You know, whether that's if they want to cry, it's nah, boys, don't do that, hush up, or be tough, or whatever the case is. So I think now it has to be more socially acceptable to allow a young person to express themselves, because, you know, feelings and emotions aren't gender specific. You know, they're open to everybody. It's just been an issue with allowing or accepting a boy or a man to do that. And then when you do that, the emotional maturity is halted at that point. So he can be 10 years old and now going the rest of his life without expressing in fear of those repercussions of being told he's soft or weak or whatever. So I think society has done a disservice by equating vulnerability to weakness. And it's up to us to change those stigmas.
Thank you for that. And Janine, since you kind of specialize working with young women, what are you seeing with them that is effective or signs to look for?
You know, similar things, certainly challenges there socially, you know, with social media, bullying, you know, behavior, wanting to withdraw from their peers and things like that, because it's just, there's a lot of pressure. And so, you know, just everything that we're seeing happening with young boys, we're kind of also seeing the same thing with girls. So it's just important to continue to encourage, inspire, keep the conversation going, checking in, you know, with our youth to make sure that they're doing okay. But we're seeing kind of the same stuff here on the girl side too.
Very good. Before I turn it over to our guests to ask questions, from the panels, Janine, James, or Dr. Robinson, anything else that you want to elaborate on that we discussed or wanted to add on? Any important points that we should hit on?
Yeah, I mean, I think for the adults, I think it's definitely important that, you know, we lead by example. So if that is doing therapeutic exercise, let the young ones know it's okay to do those things. It's okay to have their own advocacy, their own outlets. I think those things are definitely important. So they'll know, oh, it's okay. I can express myself this way, or I can say no, or I can take a break. I think a lot of times, you know, people glorify overworking, but not so much the rest aspect. So, you know, we have to say, hey, you've been running all day. Let's sit down this time, or let's do something different. Let's do something a little bit more relaxing, you know, so they'll know. And I think it's definitely important that we continue to highlight there is a difference between mental health and mental illness. I think the stigma is cast over the illness piece, because when you think of going to see somebody for a mental health aspect, they automatically think, you know, like this drastic Hollywood scene where somebody is irate or breaking stuff, or don't, you know, opposed to just a checkup, a service providing, you know, just to follow up. So I think we definitely have to continue to have those conversations and break those stigmas of those negative connotations that's been passed down, whether it's through media, social media, or just Hollywood.
Great, thank you. Anything else, Dr. Robinson, you would like to share before you open it up to our guests?
Yes, and I would just want to say for both sides, for a mentor and for the children that and teenagers that we are working with, we just want to remember to be able to create a safe space for them, but then also a safe space for us. That's all.
Absolutely. So like I said, at this time, I would love to open it up to our audience here. Questions for our panelists, either for all of them or a specific panelist. And you can just go ahead and unmute yourself and tell us your name and your question.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Tim Grimes. I'm with AMP Metro Richmond. And I just a quick comment. I found myself listening to this because it applied to me as much as it applied to anyone I'm mentoring at the time, which I really appreciate. It's been interesting times for a lot of different reasons, for, you know, COVID, for everything, for adjustments in life. And it's been so helpful, not only to how I would communicate and be aware of things with my mentee, but certainly many things that I could use myself.
Thank you, Tim. Anyone else on the line that has a question for our panelists?
This is Tashara. I have a question about the services that you all offer. Are your services virtual, or they're in person, or they're hybrid? And how does someone go about connecting with you all?
For me, this is Janine. So we offer a hybrid of both in person and virtual. It's myself and my resident. And we do ask that if somebody is coming in person that, you know, we're wearing masks and we are practicing social distancing as well. You can reach me through my website at www.iamlivingwellness.com. I'm also on Psychology Today. There's a profile there, and my resident also has a profile as well. And you can reach me by phone, 443-272-1429 as well.
And this is Dr. Robinson. I'm strictly virtual right now. I can be reached by email at robinsonandassociates18, all spelled out, at gmail.com. And you can also call the office at 804-592-1066. And we also offer services and treatment to the Latinx community as well.
Yeah, so I'm James Harris. The easiest way to find me is my website, www.mentohealth.com, mentohealth.com. And from there, of course, you can get my email, my social media, my YouTube, my book, anything that I have going on. But my services are both, you know, in person and hybrid or online. And I'm open to working with anybody that's available that need assistance or a resource. There's also a resource page on my website with different hotlines, different shelters, and you know, clothing opportunities and things like that for the community. My information is in the chat too. I know some people might be driving or doing something else, so they can just get that out of the chat.
Others that may have questions for our panelists?
Yeah, hello, good morning, everyone. My name is Rebecca. I work with like a group of teenagers, and we do mentoring programs here in Northern Virginia called Casa Chilagua, is our Christian Community Center. But I just wanted to know, I've noticed with a pattern with the teens is a lot of them feeling, I guess, just disengaged with just like school and different assignments. And so my question for the panelists is just, I guess, what is your, how do you engage the teens in identifying like what they're passionate about and giving them projects or ideas for that they enjoy rather than feeling like they're always doing what they're told to do? I think they sometimes feel like there's not much under their control. So I wanted to hear about what your experience has been in engaging them and doing things that they want to do.
Mm-hmm. Well, working with the teens that I work with, you know, we try to explore what are their strengths, what are their interests, what are they really good at, what are they talented at, what do they like to do, and maybe what are a few things that they're interested in trying, but they haven't done it yet, you know, because sometimes there may be things that they may find interesting that they've never thought about before. So just really encouraging them to maybe try sports, maybe try drawing or arts, or just getting yourself out there and doing things that you would not normally do to see if there's a passion there. Because yeah, sometimes they don't have a clue, you know, as to what they're really good at. Asking them what they value. You know, I talk a lot with my clients about values, what's important to you in life, and seeing if there's anything generated from that type of discussion.
And also, in addition to what you said, I have my clients do two vision boards. One vision board is what is it that you want to do? And the other vision board is what do you think everybody else wants you to do? And now they have an option to compare and contrast. So, oh man, I want to do all this stuff and other people want me to do this and I don't want to do none of that, what they want to do, or people want me to do this and I also want to do this. So, all right, cool. I'm in the right spot. You know, so by doing two of them, you get to focus on that sweet spot opposed to, you know, because young kids, they feel guilty about disappointing others. So whether that's a parent or a teacher or just other peers. So now by doing two of them, they can say, well, I do want to do this because mom suggested or dad suggested it, and it's something that I really want to do. Or I don't want to do none of that. So let me tell mom and dad that, you know, this is what I want to do truly. So now don't nobody feel guilty or they don't feel as pressured to live up to those expectations, because it happened all the time. You know, a lot of parents live vicariously through our children. So by exposing them to, hey, what it is that you want, allows them to find a way. And then you probably can help them articulate that or translate that to the parent or the guardian or whomever to, hey, this is what they want to do.
I like that advice, James. I want to even do that for myself as adults. I think we get into that same space of what society thinks we should be doing and what we really want to do and finding that medium. I also like the idea for young people, because if they are not able to express themselves verbally, they have a visual that they can show adults and say, this is how I'm feeling, but this is what I'm, you know, the expectations are of me. So very good. Virginia.
Hi, yeah, my name is Virginia. I work with CCC in Roanoke, Virginia. I work mainly with refugees from different countries who I usually have a language barrier with. And so I was wondering what suggestions you would have to work around the language barrier to help them dealing with like anxiety and depression and also like PTSD and stuff from things that they've experienced. Like, what would your guys' suggestions be?
Yeah, so I think that you're dealing with a few things, being that they are refugees here, migrated here, or however they got here. You definitely want to look at the adjustment aspect, because that can overlap to certain issues. And then, of course, there is a trauma piece there as well. And it could be a portion of grief. So it's so many different factors opposed to them just with the language barrier. The language could be, you know, at the bottom of that spectrum. They're dealing with so many other things, adjusting to our norms, customs, traditions, and, you know, just atmosphere, period. So I definitely think building a cohesive bond with them would definitely benefit both of you in that instance, so they can feel comfortable and they can feel open and accepted to want to explore beyond, you know, where they are now. So building that cohesiveness, you know, whether that's doing exercises or whether you guys write notes to each other, whether you guys talking to each other. And it doesn't have to be just, well, I'm not sure the rules and regulations of where you are facility-wise, but if you can get out and explore, you know, take a walk or either walk around the facility in which you are, so you can have that one-on-one time to have them just depict what they want, you know, or draw pictures, you know, strips are definitely important, whether those are a visual or narrative. So those things probably can assist.
Thank you. And I know Tashara has a question.
Yes, as an expansion on the engagement question, how do you get youth and teens who have disengaged from school back re-engaged? The issue that I'm finding and I'm seeing is that it's not a matter of not knowing how to do the work. And it's not a matter of, it's not even a matter of grades. It's just a complete disengagement of even having a desire to do it, or even wanting to do it, or even completing it. So how do we get them re-engaged in school? Because unfortunately, we know that it's something that they have to do.
I wonder if working with them on, you know, kind of discussing what they value about the school experience, and even going back to what James said about a vision board, I wonder if that would be helpful too, that they can create a vision of what, you know, the next 5 years, the next 2 years, the next year looks like for themselves and how school kind of fits into that. And the importance of maintaining grades or maintaining academics as it relates to their goals and the vision, you know, that they have for themselves. And just sort of working with them on changing the narrative about school. Maybe they're having negative thoughts about, you know, participating in school, doing their grades and different things like that. So finding value in it, and then also helping them to formulate some goals on what they, you know, and just staying focused on what those goals are and the steps that they're gonna have to take to reach them, which possibly includes school.
And I think we gotta have that conversation with them. Like, how can I help you have a better experience? What is it that you need from me or from your teachers to make you want to engage more, or to make you want to participate more? Or how can I assist you raising these grades up? Do you need a tutor? Do you need one-on-one time? Do you need more breaks? You know, you can, collaborate with the teacher in those efforts, but I think it starts with talking to your young one and figuring out what they need, you know, and hopefully you guys are at a relationship to where they'll be transparent enough or open enough to tell you what they probably can benefit from in that atmosphere, whether it's, I just need to take a break every now and again, or I don't like my teacher, or, you know, I'm not understanding what their assignments are. You know, so from there, I think you'll get answers and then you can formulate a plan. But unless you ask or have those conversations, you know, it'll all be guesses.
And I just want to piggyback off of what Janine and James said. And then sometimes literally just ask those questions as to what is possibly going on. We have to dig deep, because sometimes it's really not, you know, well, I really don't know whatever was going on. It could be that, but maybe it's something else, like underlying bullying. You know, because sometimes kids think that they can handle it, or they don't want to add to what mom or dad or my caregiver is going to. So they'll suppress it. They'll keep it in, and then it'll come out as to, well, why are your grades looking like this? Well, why don't you want to do this? Well, didn't you have a test? Why didn't you study? So if we literally take, you know, finding out what the goals are, what motivation is, how James said, find out, help me help you, to help you be great, but then also, okay, let's put all the cards on the table. You know, what steps do I as the caregiver need to take? Is it actually going to the school, calling in, you know, parents to say, hey, you know, did you know? Or even just talking with the principal, hey, did you know? Because a lot of times they don't. So hopefully that helps.
Thank you so much. And I know Sarah Jenkins had a question in the chat box, and she was curious about free and reduced health, mental health resources. And Sarah, if you want to also jump on the line to elaborate.
I was just wondering if I know sometimes parents talk to us about looking for, you know, therapists or something for their child, but they don't have a lot of resources to, you know, give towards that. And I was wondering if you all knew of any, you know, I know we have like, you know, BetterHelp for adults. I don't know if there's a BetterHelp for kids or anything like that that you might be aware of.
I think it would be the same. You can go to those websites in which you go to for adults and see if they have people who work with children in that bio. Psychology Today, of course, NAMI.org is a good resource as well. BetterHelp is a good resource. And you can see if they offer sliding scales, if it is a situation of fee, because I think I heard free or reduced. So you can see if it is a situation to where you can get a pro bono session, or, you know, just ask as many questions as you can within that intake. Most therapists offer a 15-minute consultation. So see if it's the right fit, not only from a financial standpoint, but from a standpoint of my child would benefit and build with this person. Because by the time I see, in many cases, by the time I get this young male, it from the parent or from the courthouse or from wherever, it's always been, oh, he had three previous therapists or four previous therapists and none of them fit. You know, but by the time I work with them, it's a different story. So I think that can be prevented if they did those consultation sessions and making sure it's the right fit. So you can definitely do that off those websites, which would be beneficial.
And I would also like to add that as you're looking, you know, through those websites like Psychology Today and some of those other resources, see if there are any interns or residents, because some of them can offer some pro bono services or at a reduced rate. I have a resident at my practice who does see clients at a reduced rate as well. So that could be another option to explore.
Thank you. Those are all great resources. We're going to begin to wrap up our session here, but I wanted to thank Janine and James and Dr. Robinson for this conversation. Even in the chat box, we're having people say this is wonderful, great tips. We will certainly have your contact information for follow-up for others as well. But as we close, I wanted to give some of our own closing announcements about Mentor Virginia. We will follow up with a survey to get your feedback on this coffee session. And also, just to put on your calendar for our next community coffee hour, which will be on Wednesday, December 8th. And the topic there will be partnering with schools for mentoring. Mm-hmm. And also, as many of you know, some of you have been participating in our 6-part workshop on the elements of effective practice. That is upcoming as well for the next one. To look for that. And just as a reminder to our program partners that no cost assistance is available. We have opened up now to take your requests so that we can help you with the technical assistance of your programs, consulting. We have, you know, especially if you're looking for an e-mentoring program, we have some things going on with that we can help with. So just going onto our website to apply for those services or contacting Sarah Wilkinson, our program manager, for more questions about that. So, like I said, it has been an absolute pleasure being here with our panelists. I know, and if any of you want to unmute yourself and thank them personally, I would welcome that too.
Thank you, everyone. This is Curtis Hall, New College Solutions Youth Coach. Appreciate everything that was shared. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.